Hello, everybody. I'm Shantae Price, Director of West Tennessee and Urban Services for STEP, Support and Training for Exceptional Parents, Tennessee's Parent Training and Information Center. We are federally funded to assist families for free with their child's special education questions. Today, I'm going to be discussing IDEA timelines. I will recap the established IDEA timelines and talk about what schools are still required to do to follow these timelines, noting any flexibility or waivers that are currently in effect. Now, in the state of Tennessee, most students have already started back to school for the 2020-2021 school year. Some students are attending in person, some are all virtual. Some are a combination of the two. And as a school year like no other gets underway, it's important to remember that the laws surrounding IEPs and Section 504 plans remain unchanged. In other words, the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, or IDEA, and Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act guarantee students with disabilities the right to a free, appropriate public education and protect them from discrimination. In spite of this ongoing pandemic, these laws have not changed. They have not been repealed, and there are no waivers to them. They are still in effect, as well as their associated federal and state timelines. And parents and families should continue to fight for the services that their children need. IDEA, Section 504, nor the Department of Education has said anything like, you can only do this, or you must do that. Schools have to continue to follow the laws and provide what is reasonable. Now, what that looks like will look different from student to student. So as schools have reopened and as educators and students across the state navigate a virtual learning environment, schools must ensure learning for all students, regardless of the student's learning environment, whether they're learning in a school building or remotely. Districts must make every effort to the greatest extent possible to provide special education and related services to the student in accordance with his or her IEP or 504 plan. Now, many students in Tennessee receive special education services. Some have IEPs, which are tailored to an individual student's disability and include special services, while others have 504 plans, which allows students with disabilities accommodations and/or modifications in the classroom. It's imperative that children with disabilities receive the services that they need during this critical and unprecedented time. School districts are working really hard to figure things out, and we recommend that parents be patient and reasonable. Schools and families are encouraged to work together as collaborators, but at the same time, parents still need to hold schools accountable and make sure that their children get the services that they need. Now, services for students with disabilities may not look the same as they have, as they used to, but with collaboration, parents and educators can work together to meet their children's needs. Families should continue to approach the 504 and IEP processes much like they would in any other year. Now, while the details may look a bit different, for example, meetings occurring virtually rather than in person, again, COVID does not change things under the law. Some schools are giving parents the option of keeping their children home, even if campuses reopen. For example, in cases where children are medically fragile or especially vulnerable to contracting COVID-19. However, schools have to continue providing online learning and related services in those cases. Another example, some districts are telling parents that all the students with disabilities are going back to school 5 days a week. Making blanket placement decisions based on a student's disability category is contrary to the law. The decision about the services and where they're going to take place should be the last part of the IEP process. The whole concept of the IEP is that services for students with disabilities should be individualized. The IEP team should consider the student's present levels of performance, their needs, their goals, and how to meet them before making any determination about placements. Overall, special education has been a challenge for school districts since March, when schools closed due to the pandemic. For example, many students in special education receive occupational therapy, speech therapy, and/or physical therapy, services that are nearly impossible to provide virtually. And then due to social distancing guidelines, services for some students have been delayed. And yet other students, such as those with ADHD, often have difficulty following lessons online. Parents can still request an IEP team meeting at any time to address their child's needs. And parents should request an IEP meeting if services have to be modified due to the coronavirus, or if schedules have to be adjusted. For example, agreeing to 2 days a week of virtual instruction versus 5 days a week. And the details about those arrangements should be documented in the student's IEP. Now, for students with disabilities, there are certain requirements related to timelines that have to be followed. So now I'm going to share my screen, and I'm going to recap the 2019-2020 school closure timeline and associated requirements and flexibility. Okay, so this table summarizes the timelines, associated requirements, and flexibility that were available during school closures for the spring semester of the 2019-2020 school year due to COVID-19. Now, to recap this document, I'm also going to discuss the current impact that this flexibility has on the current 2020-2021 school year, which should now be coming to a close. But starting with initial evaluations. So IDEA provides that initial evaluations must be conducted within 60 calendar days of receiving parental consent. Initial evaluations that were in progress prior to school closures and during school closures had allowable timeline extensions. The evaluation timeline was extended to 90 calendar days. Now, due to the states of emergency at the federal and the state levels, evaluations initiated or in process after March, on or after March 30th, 2020, could be completed within 90 calendar days of receipt of parental consent, rather than the usual 60-day requirement. Now, if an evaluation of a student with a disability required a face-to-face assessment or observation, the evaluation would need to be delayed until school reopened. Evaluations and reevaluations that did not require face-to-face assessments or observations could have taken place while schools were closed, as long as the student's parent or legal guardian consented. Now, these same principles apply to similar activities conducted by appropriate personnel for student with a disability who had a plan developed under Section 504 who was being evaluated under Section 504. Okay, reevaluations. IDEA provides that reevaluations must be conducted at least once every 3 years. Now, for reevaluations due during the school closures, teams should complete the reevaluation as soon as possible upon return to school. Also, for reevaluations due while students are attending a virtual instructional setting, cases should be treated on an individual basis. Now, however, every attempt should be made to complete the reevaluation to the extent possible, given reasonable access to the student. Districts and schools were strongly encouraged to document any decisions related to these reevaluation timelines and were encouraged to maintain that decision-making rationale in the student's file. Now, IEPs. For initial IEPs, a meeting to develop an IEP for a student must be conducted within 30 days of a determination that the student needs special education and related services. As soon as possible following the development of the IEP, special education and related services must be made available to the student in accordance with the student's IEP. Now, the flexibility provided here is that the term, as soon as possible, recognized that because of closure due to the pandemic, districts may have needed to delay the start of special education and related services to a particular student. However, these services are to be provided as soon as possible upon school reopening, as determined by the IEP team. Again, districts and schools were strongly encouraged to document any decisions related to these IEP timelines and to maintain that decision-making rationale in the student's file. Now, annual IEP meetings and IEP reviews. IDEA requires that the student's IEP be reviewed at least annually, and that the IEP be revised as appropriate. Districts should make every attempt to conduct annual IEP team meetings that are due during periods of school closure. Now, there was some flexibility in this provision. So for example, in making changes to a student's IEP after the annual IEP team meeting for a school year, the parent of a child with a disability and the LEA may agree not to convene an IEP team meeting for the purposes of making those changes, and instead may develop a written document to amend or modify the student's current IEP. And in addition, when conducting IEP team meetings and placement meetings, the parent of a child with a disability and an LEA may agree to use alternative means of meeting participation requirements, such as video conferences and conference calls. Now, other items to note regarding IEP team meetings. Now, IEP team meeting timelines may be extended only if the LEA has reasonably determined that the use of virtual technology is not a suitable method of conducting the required meeting, or information necessary for the IEP team's deliberation is not attainable due to recommendations of the state or local health departments that limit access to important student records. So these decisions must include the student's parent or guardian and meaningfully work towards ensuring that each student receives an IEP review appropriate with the intent of the law and in the best interest of the student. And again, districts and schools were strongly encouraged to document any decisions related to annual reviews and to maintain that decision-making rationale in the student's file. Now, as for the current 2020-2021 school year, the timelines in Tennessee special education remain the same. Now, here are the established timelines for Tennessee. And I reiterate, schools are still required to follow these timelines, and there are no waivers or flexibility to these timelines for the current school year. Now, for the sake of time, I won't go through each one of these, but this specific chart, the timelines in Tennessee special education, can be assessed via STEP's online parent manual that is available for download on our website at tnstep.org. Okay, but I do quickly want to point out and go over this very important section at the top of the page, which states the definition of a day. This area is pretty important because it defines the definition of a day as it's specified. And it says, or it gives the definitions as starting here with a day. A day is a calendar day unless otherwise indicated as a business day or a school day. A business day is defined as Monday through Friday, except for federal and state holidays. And a school day is defined as any day, including a partial day, that children are in attendance for instructional purposes. And I also want to remind parents of this. For special education referrals or parent requests for an evaluation, all special education referrals or parent requests for a special education evaluation should still be considered within a reasonable period of time. Any relevant information should be collected to help the referral team make an informed decision as to whether there is reason to suspect an educational disability. If the team suspects a disability, the team must initiate the evaluation process by obtaining consent for evaluation and providing the parent with prior written notice. Now, all evaluation criteria and eligibility guidelines are still required. If the team does not suspect a disability, it may decide not to evaluate, but it must provide the parent with prior written notice. Again, this two-page document can be accessed via STEP's online parent manual on pages 219 through 220, and it is available for download on our website at tnstep.org. And if you have any questions about any of this information, please feel free to reach out to any one of us. Now, while this has certainly been a time unlike any other, and as a school year like no other gets underway, just remember again, the laws surrounding IEPs and Section 504 plans and their associated timelines have not changed. To date, the U.S. Department of Education has declined to seek any meaningful modifications to the laws as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, and schools are still required to develop plans to meet the needs and service requirements of students with disabilities. Now, that means that your child should continue to be placed in the setting that's most appropriate and agreed upon by the IEP team, and any reconfiguring of classes that result from COVID do not change that. Now, any changes to your child's IEP must be based on your child's needs and not simply the programs the school currently offers, and no changes should be made without giving you, the parent, a chance to give input. In fact, if you need assistance, STEP is here for you in every region of Tennessee. For one-on-one assistance, give us a call at area code 423-639-0125 and get our extensions by name. You can also email us at information@tnstep.org. Again, that's information@tnstep.org, or visit our website at tnstep.org. Thanks for joining me today. I hope this information has been helpful.